Greetings and welcome back to room 303 in our talks with Walt, as we call our readings through the deathbed edition of Walt Whitman's Leaves of Grass. We are in Song of the Broadax, passage number 2, what is sometimes referred to as the welcome section of some 14 different times in this brief set of lines. We're going to get the word welcome used. We're also going to get the word lands emphasized over and over again. 17 times the word lands is going to get used. Now, our assumptions are that you've been following our stuff at learnstrong.net down the left-hand side, Talks with Walt, the name of our playlist. And we've been giving lectures on every single line of Leaves of Grass, from the inscriptions, poems, all the way up to and including Song of the Broadax, passage number 1. And our hope is that you've been following along in your own copy of Leaves of Grass, annotating as you go. Now, the background information for passage number 2 here is to and you can kind of jot this down and have this kind of set in your mind as we get ready to read this, the relationship between the axe and the place the axe came from, the earth. I mean, think about that. The metal comes from the earth. The handle of the axe comes from a tree that obviously grows in the earth. So that's going to be significant here. As well, this notion of, again, unity and diversity. We've got various types of lands that are going to be described here. And I think there's a couple of really famous texts that are going to resonate here. We'll look at least 3 when we get to level 3A. Let's just enjoy the poem now. Welcome are all earth's lands, each for its kind. And if you want to go back to starting from Pamanok, passage 9, make welcome for them everywhere, this idea of welcome. And if you'll think about it, Whitman has really tried in Leaves of Grass to be such an inclusivist poet, an artist that reaches out and says to everyone, hey, you know, we're all a part of this thing. Welcome, welcome. Hospitality, right? That ancient Greek notion that he would have learned from his study of the Iliad and the Odyssey, xenia, as we've talked about it in lectures elsewhere at learnstrong.net. Notice, all Earth's lands, each for its kind, and readers of Whitman's day immediately would resonate with Genesis 1:24. You can go and take a look at that on your own. Welcome are lands of, now we're going to get 4 trees, of pine and oak. Welcome are lands of the lemon and fig. Right? Then we're going to jump from there to gold and minerals, and we'll come back to gold in a little bit. Welcome our lands of gold. Welcome our lands of wheat and maize. Obviously, we think about leaves of grass, grass. Welcome those of the grape. Welcome our lands of sugar and rice. Obviously, these are all edibles. Welcome the cotton lands. Now we're going to get to some economics and crops of economics. Welcome those of the white potato and sweet potato. And by the way, we should pause. You can think about the history of America in terms of crops, and any number of scholars have played this game. That is to say, what we grow out of the ground in this country is in large measure the history of this country. It's what brought people here, and it is what has allowed for certain kinds of economics to be in play. Obviously, some horrifying realities. We think of slavery, obviously, but not just slavery. We think of indentured service from any number of different types of people who arrive here as immigrants, which will obviously make us think about the Statue of Liberty, and we might just get there in a second as we play the game out. Welcome the cotton lands. Welcome those of the white potato and sweet potato. Welcome our mountains. Now we're going to talk about different kinds of lands. Mountains, flats, sands, forests, prairies, 5 different types of geography being played with here. Welcome the measureless, we've commented on his idea of the limitlessness of America, grazing lands. Welcome the teeming soil of orchards, flax, honey, hemp. Now, the moment that you see the word teeming, you cannot help but, of course, think about that really famous poem, the Statue of Liberty poem, is the way most of you think about it, the New Colossus of Emma Lazarus. Think about that one, 1883, right? If you want to play around with dates. 1883, and those lines, give me your tired, your poor, your huddled masses yearning to breathe free, the wretched refuse of your teeming shores. That idea of teeming, obviously playing around, and obviously the use of the word soil makes us, we're so familiar with the way he's used that word so many times. Orchard, flax, honey, hemp. By the way, notice his use of the word hemp several times in Leaves of Grass, for those of you who are at all interested in running that one to ground, no pun intended. Welcome just as much, now that just as much, no throwaway, just as much the other more hard-faced lands. So this is it. Poet as inclusivist. artist as always including everyone in the process, right, of welcoming. Rich lands, rich as lands of gold or wheat and fruit lands. In other words, all lands are important, even the lands that don't produce either gold or product of crops or whatever. Lands of mines, obviously, axe heads come from under the ground. Lands of mines, lands of the manly and rugged ores. Remember from passage one, it was masculine trades. Now it's manly and rugged ores. Lands of coal, copper, lead, tin, zinc. Lands of iron. Obviously, we've got six of those all listed. All of the different things that can be extracted. And then finally, lands of the make of the axe. In other words, the point he's wanting to make in his symbolism is that the axe is a product of all of these different kinds of lands and therefore can stand as a symbol for the very land. And there's an argument from a study of his notebooks that in fact Whitman liked this this word picture of the axe even more than he liked the word picture of the notion of an eagle, because within the symbolism of the axe for him, as referenced in this poem, there's so many different conclusions that can be drawn. Now at 2A, our themes messages here write, some land is productive and useful, some land, of course, is desolate and barren, but it is all necessary, and that's going to be his real key. And true artists, therefore, or poets, are those who are inclusivist in their thinking. They want all voices involved, everyone's voice involved. If we find ourselves ever trying to exclude voices because of any number of reasons, whatever those can be, Whitman would say to us, we have to stop it. Because why? Lands are of different kinds. Obviously, we're speaking now in metaphor, aren't we? At 2B, well, the repetition of welcome 14 times and land 17 times, it becomes really kind of almost like a mantra when you read it. At 3A, there's a couple of times, I mean, we've already mentioned M.O. Lazarus's 1883, The New Colossus, but how about Woody Guthrie's 1944, This Land Is Your Land, This Land Is My Land? There's an argument to be made that Guthrie is echoing so much of what Whitman is playing, not just here. Of course, Whitman has played this game before in Leaves of Grass. I also like to make the point when I can of the ways in which some of these echoes resonate for our study of T.S. Eliot's Four Quartets. Of course, poems that in 303 we consider really important. Remember these final lines from Little Gidding and the very last lines of Four Quartets. And consider this notion of the source as being so central to our reading of this set of lines. He says it this way, we shall not cease from exploration, and the end of all our exploring will be to arrive where we started and know the place for the first time. Through the unknown remembered gate, when the last of earth left to discover is that which was the beginning, at the source of the longest river, the voice of the hidden waterfall and the children in the apple tree, not known because not looked for, but heard, half heard, in the stillness between two waves of the sea. This idea of the source, everything comes from the earth for Whitman, and therefore we have to somehow understand the importance of every element of our country, all of the peoples of our country. This, of course, can lead us to the question of, how about you? Do you feel welcomed in America? Are you a welcoming person to all people in America? Certainly a powerful way to read this set of lines. How about this one? What land or lands most attracts you? If you're wanting to go out, for example, and visit America, what are the lands that attract you the most? And what are the ones that maybe you're not so attracted to, and yet maybe you could become more appreciative of them? As we often say about texts in 303, it's not that we like them, it's that we learn how to respect them. And to that degree, what is it that can be respected by you? Taking a drive across America, right? We think about On the Road, right? The famous text. But to take Whitman with you and to play that game, even more remarkable, and to read a set of lines like this, we now will jump to passage number 3. The cataloging is going to happen again, the longest passage in all of Broad Acts, and we're going to come back now to study more closely and to show those elements and attributes. I hope you're enjoying our study of Whitman. Thank you.